visitors we have with us this morning. If you are a guest with us this morning, we have yellow and green cards in the pew rack. Yellow and green, yes. Yellow and green guest cards in the pew rack. And if you would fill one of those out and put it in the offering plate, we'd love to have a little more information about who you are. We're glad you joined us this morning. Let's take a few moments to say hello.
Rather than prisoners of life's circumstances.
Therefore,
we will rejoice in the Lord always, because the Lord is my help and my God.
Father, we're thankful to be hearing the voice that gathers us up this morning. Whether it's a simple habit of ours, or whether it's a sense of need that brought us this morning, or whether it's the real opportunity that we want to take to say thank you for all the blessings of our lives. We gather because you have called us, and we're thankful that we can hear that bidding in our lives. We're thankful for those who are around us, for the friendship, the fellowship, the family spirit that we share. And we claim this morning the wonder of what you promised to us, the gift of the Holy Spirit that dwells within the hearts of those who trust you. And that is the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the one who walks with us every step of life, who empowers us and brings to mind all that you have done and said, who strengthens us and teaches us in all truth. Our joy is in you, O Lord. Be welcome and present in our midst this morning, and help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
On the screen, when it says all, that's
Every
father can raise their hand. Every Sunday school teacher can raise their hand. Every serving person who's taken a role in the church, deacon or simple role of any sort, Kathy Franklin sitting back there on the register in the back in the foyer, you can raise your hand. As an usher, you are an encourager. Bill Capel, hidden behind all the technology up there, you can raise your hand, Bill. All of us have that kind of experience. Today I am so thankful for a faithful deacon who has really been fighting a tough battle with lots of difficulties and cancer and all, and has the scars to prove it. AC. Thank you, AC, for all of our work, years and years, believing in education, fighting for Sunday school, and hanging in here even when Dan was difficult. I mean, when the church was difficult. When you had to swim upstream or across the currents, you did it. We're so grateful for people who hang in there and fight for what's right and do what is good. And then, even when you don't feel like it, you keep trying to show up. We're praying for your strength. Holly Vogel's song was also another one. She and her husband, Vogel sang, who enjoyed bringing a bright spirit on Sunday mornings and fixing fellowship food, goodies, for a long, long time. And always having the bread. She and her husband always having the bread. She fell and broke her shoulder while she got into her later years and was no longer able to drive herself to church. Some people brought her, and after a while, she moved out of town to be with her daughter. She went on to be with the Lord this week, as did Margaret Metcalf. People like this have meant a lot to us in little ways, in little things they decided to do in fellowship of the church. We all have become more than what we might have been had it not been for the lives of others who have impacted us, who've done just little things, consistently kept them up, because of their convictions and because of their love for you, because of their strong beliefs. Many of them have been swimming across the currents, upstream. We're thankful for AC. We pray for his strength, Lord. But most of all, we know that his hand, his life is in your hands, and we're thankful that whether he's seated in the chair at home or recovering in the hospital room or whether he's here in the pew with us, his life is in your hands. We're thankful for that assurance. Bless each one of us to become more like those who have influenced us. In Jesus' name. And in his spirit. And in his character. And with his same heart and belief and love and desire to love you in that same way. In Jesus' name. If you know Ron Springs, you know him as whatever kind of character you've seen him display, whatever role you've seen him play. If he's a friend of yours, he's a gentle and tender and jovial, good-hearted friend. You want to be around him. If you go to lunch with him, most of the time he stiffs you unless you pay for his lunch. If you've seen him at the boys' camp, at the girls' camp at Ridgecrest, he's really amazing, but he always keeps himself behind the scenes. But everything that's happening out there, power of new buildings and new stuff, and I've changed lives of kids because of his thinking and playing. If you've seen him in choir, you sing for him, you know that he's encouraging, but he's unrelenting. He works you hard. So wherever you've seen him, whatever kind of relationship you've seen him, you know about his character. He's either a real sweetheart, a real pussycat, or you might have known him as a tiger. I'm going to read you two scriptures about Jesus. Not about mine. Two scriptures about Jesus. And they present Jesus in different ways, at different times, in different circumstances. And so we have an unusual presentation of Jesus contrasting one way from the other. And so many people draw their impressions about who Jesus is and was according to what they know about him or where they've experienced him. I'll read to you from Matthew 23 and from Luke 9. I ask you to stand with me in honor of reading God's word. Matthew 23, starting with the 33rd verse, begins this way. You snakes, you brood of vipers, how will you escape being burned in hell? I bet you haven't heard that. Therefore, I'm sending you prophets and wise men and teachers. Some of them you will kill and crucify. Others you will flog in the synagogues and pursue from town to town. And so upon you will come all of the righteous blood that has been shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. I tell you the truth, all of this will come upon this generation. And as he turns, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who killed the prophets and stoned those who sent to you, how often I long to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And in the 9th chapter of Luke, 51st verse, as the time approached for him to be taken to heaven, Jesus set his face like flint for Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead and went into Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was headed not for their place. He was headed for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to destroy them? Jesus turned and rebuked them. And they went on to another village. Lord, you provided for us a record of who you are, who Christ is, and how we can know you and trust you and live for you. May that be what we draw from this morning. In Jesus' name. Two pictures of Jesus. Lion. Or lamb? Which one of us? Years ago, I stumbled across a little book by Bruce Barton entitled The Man Nobody Knows. And his purpose was to show that Christ was commonly thought of as weak, sweet-natured, harmless, pacifistic, and helpless man. And he was properly symbolized as the lamb. But that picture is the farthest from the truth when you start reading the book of Luke. Luke shows us that Jesus was incredibly strong, fearless, fierce even, undaunted, and called more accurately by so many, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. A lot of people perpetuate the lamb picture, the gentle Jesus. Dr. Luke shows us anything else but that. His portrait of the ideal man shows us that his most prominent feature was his courage. Oftentimes I've wondered, maybe you have too, why we don't have pictures of the face of Jesus. We have Saltzman, who was an imagined face of Jesus, but we don't have pictures of the way he looked. And I think it's because his character was so powerful. The way he lived and what he lived was so powerful that it almost outshone any actual memories of the actual looks of Jesus. Remember when he was seized by his hometown people in Nazareth and they were hostile and the mob was about to murder him? And Luke just says, and he walked right out through the midst of them and went on his way. There was another time when he was to leave the country because Herod was after him to destroy him. He turned turned and said with a tart remark, "You tell that old fox, get this, I cast out demons. I cure the sick today and I will tomorrow. And on the third day, I will be made complete." So first of all, let's look at some of the parts of his character. He was a defiant person in the face when wrong was spoken. He proclaimed that he would be crowned by something higher than a tin can crown passed on to a puppet ruler from a false and powerless kingdom. Whew. He didn't mince any words when he stood before people who were pushing their weight around. He didn't like bullies. He didn't like bullies who stood around among the people and flexed their muscle and claimed their way and screamed about who had the power to do things. How different for most of us. While Jesus is standing up, many of us have decided we ought to just sit down because we don't want to draw attention to ourselves. We don't want to get in trouble. We don't want to stir up conflict. We don't want to get into disfavor. Heaven forbid, we don't want to get ourselves in any kind of trouble. Jesus was fiery, courageous, and standing up defiant when things were wrong. That's why he's our Savior. He was also very determined. No less than 10 chapters, Luke paints a picture of the determination that Jesus had when he decided to go to Jerusalem, that it had to be dealt with at the place where the power pours out. He set his face like flint to Jerusalem, the capital city, the heart of power, the place where real issues are dealt with and real decisions are made. It's almost as if you could almost imagine, here is a person who, in my imagination, gets elected to a small city area, and he's concerned about it. So next he runs for actual city council, and he gets elected. And then he becomes a state representative. And then he becomes the governor of the state, and finally gets so concerned that he gets out and gets elected for Congress, and he makes his way all the way to Washington. And when he finally gets there, he sits there, and he listens and listens and listens till he can hear no more. And he stands up before the whole crowd and shouts, "Enough! Enough! No more playing games or pretending to govern. Today we start helping people. Today we start telling the truth. Today we start calling a spade and asking God's guidance before we take another step." Now that's the kind of determination Jesus had. Wouldn't that be something? But he stuck with it because it was a sense of duty also. It was a duty to God and a duty to the people that he was sent to serve. He would not let things just go by. If it was wrong, it was going to be addressed. If it weakened the sense of the power of God, or the power of God was lesser than the traditions or the power of the people, he spoke about it until finally he took a whip and went into the temple. And in a rage, he cleared it out. "No more business at church. This is a place of prayer," he said, "for all nations." He went about it like a duty. He felt like he was answering to God every time he had the chance to speak. You and I should hear this Lamb of God roar like a lion. This is the Lenten season. We're trying to get a clearer picture of the real Jesus. Because all through the year, we imagine Jesus. We think Jesus likes what we do, and Jesus is backing up the kinds of things that we do that make us be his church. If you have done more doings than listening to the Lord, you might have missed how serious Jesus was about setting his face like flint for Jerusalem. Here's the picture of the lion. They thought he was just one man, a prophet from a small town in Nazareth who had a little fire in his gut. But there he was. And you know what was the fire in his vision? It was you and me. It was ordinary people who were missing the real glory and the strength and the joy and the accomplishment in the hearts and lives of people. Sometimes we say in church, well, we don't want to count nickels and noses. But let me tell you, that registers what's going on in people's lives. Nickels and noses means people are making sacrifices and they want to be there where the presence of God is proclaimed and the life of God is compelling and where Christ and his sacrifice is told again and again and again. He came to set you free. He saw the chains that are around your feet, the shackling you down to petty little things. And he said, I want you to be free. I want you to walk with God. I want you to be influencing others. And I want you to know that you can and that God is your partner. And that every time you walk the streets of this town or in the valleys or anywhere you go with the power of the Holy Spirit with you. I want to set you free. But your sinfulness, your pride, your stubbornness, your thoughts that God likes what you do and so God is with you in your decisions, these are sinful. And I must set these aside. And finally, I'm going to set aside the final enemy that you have. And that is death. So there will be nothing to hold you back from the plan of God in your life. Over the whole detailed account, Luke places the inscription, and he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. Because that's where the decision was. Now, all the while that he set his face for Jerusalem, he didn't imagine himself on the courthouse steps making a great speech where everybody cheered him. No, instead he saw the outline of the cross. He knew what was waiting for him was a scourging, a public beating. That was the tradition at the time. He knew about the mockery that was waiting for him, no consideration for the purity of his motives. He knew that the crown of thorns would be pressed upon his brow and the blood would run down his face. He knew that the hours of agony waiting for death were waiting for him. He knew of the darkness and the aloneness and the sense of abandonment was waiting for him. During all those long hours and long days of being misunderstood while he was teaching and journeying and healing and offering unselfish touches in people's lives, he clearly saw on the horizon what was waiting for him. Lion or lamb, what do you think? He pressed on without faltering 1 minute toward the doom and the humiliation publicly that was waiting for him. I don't know about you, but I love to study the stories of heroes. I love to find people who are courageous and who do great things. I love to read their stories, but nothing I've ever read stands anywhere near the significance of the incomparable courage of Jesus. Now, when I decided to follow him, I wasn't even halfway clear about what power he had in his life and what courage he had. But I knew that he was a man of wonder and he would be my Savior. What about you? And you decided to follow him. Or teenagers, who are always sitting over there reading their gizmos. What is it about this Jesus that drew you to him? As we take this symbolic walk during this Lent season, we know that we're on the way. We're following him. We're on the same way he went. We're facing a Jerusalem ourselves. And that is, whether we're willing to put our money where our mouth is. Whether we're really willing to be his church or whether we like church the way we like. Do we have a determination to follow Christ all the way to make our life really count? Or the determination for a deep personal search in our lives to eliminate what in our lives is incompatible with really following Jesus? Do we have the determination to forgive other people the way we have been forgiven? To show kindness to others the way we have been kindly treated in Christ? Or the determination to keep on working at trying to see people for what they can be, not for just who they are now. And to see them the way Christ saw them when he died for them. Or to make the effort to go the second mile with people who spitefully use us, to give what is necessary to right some of the wrongs that have victimized some of these people and that plague all of us. Do we have the determination to go to the source of the problems rather than just picking at some of the scabs of the problems? Can we see things through like we committed ourselves early on to do when we took Jesus? It's a good time for us to consider where it is we have been heading. You've been heading to Jerusalem? Place where you can really address the main issues of God's leading in your life. We can all be excited when things are looking up for us. When things are good, we can all be excited. But we have an opportunity to do more and to be more when we really decide to follow Jesus. What is that calling in your life that he's given you? Are you facing it with determination, with resolve, and a willingness to pay the price, regardless of what the cost will be? Jesus didn't assume we were automatically equipped. He taught us how. He said, you can't do it if you don't learn to pray. So the first question for us is, how are you doing in your prayers? Has it become routine for you? Let's have a few lessons from the school of prayer that Jesus taught. He offered us the form in his own life. We call it the Lord's Prayer, but it's really the disciples' prayer. He used such ideals as these. He said, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, 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 and keep on knocking, and it will be opened to you. What do your prayers consist of? A list of prayers for sick folks, so that people won't hurt? Or have you looked at a few doors that need to be opened and prayed for those things and kept on praying and persevered in praying until you saw what the Lord said you would and would do? Do you persevere in prayer? Go back through the Gospels and read the untold list of stories that Jesus gave. The unrighteous judge, annoyed by the pleading of an injured widow, and he finally says, well, I just want to hush her up, so I'll go down there and finally give her what she wants. And Jesus said, the unrighteous judge finally will give in with persistence. Think about the holiness and wonder of our righteous God. Won't he give his children who cry out to him day and night, won't he give them what they ask for? Then there was a self-righteous Pharisee who stood up and he thanked God. Oh, things are good in my life. Thank God I have not experienced some of the troubles that some of these other people have experienced. You've been good in my life. Me and my family have it all right. We thank you, Lord. And he walked out. And the blessings of God did not go with him because there was another man on the other side of the pews who fell down and said, Lord, my life, I just can't get it right. I'm always doing it wrong. Please forgive me. And God saw his sorrow and his sincerity mixed together unmistakably. And he was made right with God, and the doors of the riches of heaven were opened to him as he walked out. Are we persevering in prayer? Or are we proudly beating our chest and saying, aren't things good? Jesus taught us so many powerful, simple stories that if you're going to bring yourself before the lion, persevere in praying. Because Jerusalem for us is a place where God knows what you're asking for, and He will answer in due time. Prayer must not be a dull habit. We must pray until we see the answers. This is one of those wonderful days of preaching. The Lenten season is when we try to draw more and more a picture of who Jesus is and get away from who we may not be for the last 12 months. And here is a lion who set his face for Jerusalem. But at Jerusalem, he became the Lamb. The only pure offering acceptable to God on the pure altar of sacrifice. He became the Lamb. He never even opened up his mouth to defend himself. His life, his perfect life, had already spoken about it enough. If it had not been heard, it was time now to let them do to him what was necessary. Along with his pure heart, his character of determination made it possible. And he became the Lamb, slain from the foundations of the earth, that our sin could be washed away. Our pride, our stubbornness, our foolishness, our ignorance, that makes us separated from God, which is what sin is, was peeled back. But you should hear Christ roaring as a lion for your own sakes. To know that you can win this world when you do it in His name or His Spirit, with a determination that he had come from an absolute belief that God is God. And this is his word. God has the glory. And he will redeem this world through his servants and through his church. Blessed be the name of the Lamb who came to take away the sins of the world. Through his name we have been born into a new creation. Be that new creation. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for the church. For here we are. We are yours. Do with us as you would have it. Have your way in our lives. Make of us what you have us to be. Cause us to be cleansed and made whole by the Lamb who gave his life for us. And give us determination like the lion that we worship. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you open your life and heart to Christ, then I invite you to do that. Or if you just need to step out and say, I need to do a better job of following Christ. And I want my church to pray for me and encourage me. Or if you are out on the outskirts of church fellowship and you've never really thrown your hat in the ring, you like to be here when things are good, but you haven't really been through the work of being the church, and you want to be, come, there's plenty of room for you here. And so we sing this wonderful closing hymn, One Another, One of My Favorites. And Catherine, I love to pick favorites. Mom says, but the church people don't know these hymns. But here we go. What is it?
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus.
Stand and sing. If you have a decision to make, come and share.
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus.
you're a guest. We're so glad to have you. We look forward to speaking to you. And we linger and like to speak to folks around us. But folks, we want to say to you, we need more visitors here. So I'm going to commission you as I send you out this morning. Preaching and singing and inspiring and working and planning for an 11 o'clock service is not just to bring you some inspiration, but it's to share what you have. So would you hear our challenge, Catherine and Ron and Jamie and Owen and I plan these worship services so that we might give you a chance to share what you have, what you know. Would you be commissioned now to start inviting more people? I don't want you to do it just to fill up the church. It's really nice to see a good full pew, but that's not the purpose. And that will never motivate you enough to keep it up in a sustained effort. But to share what we have, the joy we have of knowing Christ, of knowing we belong to Him, and knowing the wonder of God in our lives, answers to our prayers, the joy of being set free, and hope for all eternity. We need to share that. Would you be commissioned to begin to invite more people? And invite and invite and invite. And don't give up when they don't come the first time. The old Sunday school board used to teach it takes 13 invitations before you're going to see one result. So get out, get busy, and get your first 12 behind you. We want to invite you to invite others. Let's do that, please. Andy and Gail, we're so glad to have you. You've been with us two or three times and visited with Amy Rose family. Would you close us in our benediction and send us forth with the love of God and the challenge to be His people? I remind you about Polly Vogelsang's funeral services at 12 noon on Wednesday. I think the family gathers Tuesday night at Harwood, 6 to 8. Would you bow now for our time of benediction?
Father, we thank you that we need your presence. For such a sweet presence here this morning. We thank you for the message that we have heard this morning. Are you a lion or a lamb? Well, we often think of you as the lamb, but you are a lion Judah as well. And Father, I just echo the challenge for all of us that we would be ministers of reconciliation. We would go out to our neighbors and we would just invite them to church. Tell them about the love of Jesus Christ. Lord, I just pray that for all of us, we would not be intimidated, but we would be bold and share the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, the only person that has ever died for the sin of mankind to set us free and give us eternal life, Father God. So I pray today for all of us that we would be bolder in our mission for you. Bolder, Father God, in what you have.